welcome to the third MedSpring Digital Workshop on the nexus between migration and natural resources such as land, water, food, and energy. I'm Giulia Capuani, and I'm working at the Policy Office of FOCSI, which is the Federation of Italian Christian Organizations for Volunteer Service and Development Cooperation. So thanks go to our member Elvia, which invited us to chair this workshop. Secondly, I'd like to briefly introduce the topic that we are going to explore today, which is the link between natural resources and migration. In terms of food and agriculture, the Mediterranean offers a huge variety of crop diversity, which is illustrated by the fact that about one-third of the foodstuffs used by humankind comes from the Mediterranean climatic region, if not strictly from the topographic basin. Agricultural lands and grasslands occupy 40% of the territory, ranging from large intensive crops to more mixed farming systems. However, when it comes to water, resources are limited, fragile, and unevenly distributed over space. Southern countries are endowed with only 13% of the total resources. The situation in the MENA region, which stretches over 6,000 kilometers from Morocco in the west to Iran in the east, is characterized by an important water deficit. Water availability per person per year has declined sharply over the last 50 years and is today a tenth of the average global water availability, which amounts to about 5,900 cubic meters per capita. Here, farmers strive to achieve a self-sustaining agriculture. Moreover, energy production in the region still strongly relies on fossil fuels, even though there is a high potential for renewable energies, which exacerbates the environmental problems caused by extractive measures. The context is therefore one of resource scarcity if we consider water and food. Arable land is also being lost to desertification and unplanned urbanization.
The region of Kurdistan in Iraq is adopting a structure that allows to legislate autonomously in reference with the government of Iraq. This is an important point to start with. The region, autonomous region of Kurdistan, had to receive, since 2013, 250,000 refugees from Syria. And these people are concentrated in camps, now controlled by the government authorities. And up till now, the problem which were supposed to be given by this number of people at that time, not up till now, at that time, were not so difficult, because many of these refugees found their way to enter into the normal economic situation of the country. And also the population of the Kurdistan region kind of accepted this entry. The problem of the region started in 2014, June, when there was the attack in Mosul, and August, when all the Nineveh Valley was occupied by the ISIS. And we had, since that time, a number of IDPs, that means the in the individually displaced people, that reached the number of 3,300,000 in the country. The region of Kurdistan assumed the majority of these people, and in that case started to be, let's say, a bit of a problem for the host community. In any case, the problem of the host community, as a matter of fact, became very heavy starting from mid-2015, when the low price of the oil, the only source of government, and the number of people to be assisted, the increase of cost of the rents and the cost of the imported materials had a bit of complication for the population. The complication increased in 2015 when the government had to cut the salaries and to, let's say, reduce the delivery of the energy. We are receiving the electricity in a scarce way. We have to make it up with local generating power. And so that means that the situation was made a bit heavy for the local population. So that means that the vital resources became difficult all over after the mid of 2015, not before. And now they're still going on the downtrend.
Yes, actually, we are speaking here about a crisis that, or more than one crisis that has been happening in the region, in the Middle East, that has made waves of refugees and people, or displaced people, going out from their country to a safe haven, seeking security and better place, safety place in Jordan. We are speaking about Jordan here, which is a small country in the Middle East. It has scarce resources and it's living on assistance and donation from the international community. And of course, the presence of refugees and migrants in Jordan in big numbers has caused severe burdens on the in the economy of Jordan, as well as other sectors, mainly in the fields of water and power, electricity, and main services in the public sectors like health, like education, like livelihoods. And you know, the refugees and people coming outside of the country are competing with Jordanians in their livelihoods, and they are trying to find any job that can help them survive in the country, as long as they do not know about their, you know, their whereabouts or where they are going to go afterwards, because the problems of, let's say, about the Syrian and the Iraqi problems are two big challenges on Jordan. And the people of Iraq and Syria who are in Jordan do not have any clue or any evidence what will happen in the future for them. Might be a very protracted crisis in the region that make them stay in Jordan for longer periods of time. So they are stranded here in Jordan. You know, they are lacking their livelihoods. Resources are very scarce for them. So they have to rely on the NGOs and the government in order to provide them with services that can help them promote their resilience and survive under harsh conditions here in Jordan. Most of these people are waiting for durable solutions, as we call them. So either they can go back to their country or they can be resettled in third countries that accept refugees, and or to stay in Jordan permanently. Of course, this is very unusual and unaccepted, you know, solution for the Jordanian authorities, as they consider these people guests in Jordan, and there should be a time when they should leave the country to other, you know, either go back or to third countries. So this is another problem that, you know, they are facing here in Jordan. They don't have any future, clear future about aspirations, what they can do and what might be, you know, happening for them in the near future. Or so this is the, in a brief, what the situation is about here in Jordan.
The three main challenges, I think, are, first of all, these are not necessarily in order of priority. The ability to share these vital resources, land, water, and food, are resources which are limited. And host communities always feel, very diffident when newcomers come in, when migrants come in, when refugees come in. Resources are limited. how do we share? That is the main, I think, one of the main challenges. The second challenge is maybe the lack of infrastructure. Because while host communities may be willing to share, they really at times do not know how to go about in the sharing of these resources. Land is precious. It's a very, 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 very limited commodity. So is water and food. And if it needs to be reaching the people who really need land, water, and food, are there sufficient amount of infrastructural possibilities, other facilities to be able to share this, to allocate this? And the third, I think, which is also a key issue in terms of challenge, is what is maybe the government, you know, those who are in authority, those who are in power, what is their attitude both to ensure that, you know, the host communities are both welcoming and those who seek refuge in these host communities are able to share these vital resources, namely water, land, and food. These, I think, are the three major challenges.
Well, the condition on Iraq has been made difficult by a bad conflict, which was produced by the ISIS invasion of a big part of the country. As I said before, the condition, the impact on the people on food, energy, and water became heavy since the mid of 2015. Up to that time, the situation was still under control, though the prices were a bit higher, the rent was higher, but the population did not react in any way and still opened up their doors. From middle 2015, the reduction of the salaries that I said before, and all the reduction of the energy and the increase, further increase of cost of living, because all materials, all food, all items on the market were imported, started to create complications for the population. And in any case, this complication, these difficulties, never went into problems between the two entities. The Kurdish people always accepted, in a way, the conditions they were into it, and they were also the people that were defending much strongly their own land. In fact, in Erbil, you don't feel anything about this war, which is only sometime 30, 40, 50 kilometers out of the town. We had very little situation of engagement of anything. We talk about these Peshmerga, which are the defense of the country, and this is making people, let's say, calm and safe. And even if they have a reduction of the three elements that you have mentioned, food, energy, and water. Also, the water is getting a bit complicated. But the food, you know, for the IDPs, the food is provided by many donors. Of course, they are using imported food because everything is imported now. But at least the donors are supplied. In this case, at this moment, the people that suffer more are the families of the low paid Kurdish people, because they are low paid and they had their salary cut even more. So that is what I can say. to make people resilient. We are doing this job of resiliency in the camps where we are working with children, with women particularly. The women are really strong, and they are the only, let's say, future development that is that we can see possible for the return of this displaced. But the resilience is considered something that is being to be is to be, let's say, offered to the displaced people. I don't know what is going to be done for the host community, because, you know, they are not assisted. At least we do not see any assistance. Then Jabbar can tell you, because he's a man of the land also, so he can have feelings which I don't have.
Da quando è successo questa ondata di immigrazione forzata dalla popolazione, in modo particolare dalla provincia di Nineveh, questo ultimo che è stato causato dall'ISIS, anche prima di Nineveh, quelli che sono causati nel proprio sud dell'Iraq e anche della Siria. In un piccolo paese come Kurdistan, che ha solo 4 province con 5 milioni e mezzo di abitanti, ospitiamo circa 3 milioni in tutto l'Iraq, però è solo in Kurdistan ne abbiamo 1.800.000 persone che vivono in modo particolare nella zona curda, che è una piccola zona solo di 3 province. Si può dire, nonostante tutto i crisi che colpiscono questo paese, però sia da parte dell'autorità locale sia della popolazione, stanno tra di noi, tra la popolazione sia nella città che al di fuori della città, nei campi, sono liberi a circolare, sono liberi a trovare lavoro per cominciare a lavorare, sono liberi anche per uscire quando hanno l'opportunità di andare altrove, sia all'interno dell'Iraq che all'estero, in Europa o negli Stati Uniti, in Canada, in Australia. Sicuramente un po' disagi, non per la popolazione, diciamo, i disagi sul piano economico, sul piano dei servizi, delle risorse che esistano per offrire a questa popolazione, in modo particolare, come l'ha detto anche il dottor Dutto, in modo particolare l'energia, che non solo per loro, anche per la popolazione locale che manca.
Yes, for the Jordanian context, it's a little bit different. It's, we don't have, for example, the climate change as a major threat to the people of they are suffering or they are trying to promote their resilience in the country. We have other issues, like one of the problems that we have seen in the country for many years after the, you know, the exodus of the Syrians to Jordan was the rent subsidies. These went high dramatically, sometimes twice or three times, you know. This posed some kind of threat to the, you know, to their presence here in Jordan, as they no longer are able to pay for their rents, and sometimes they have to go to live in unsafe places, unsecure places, you know, places that are not having, for example, good health conditions, hygienic environment. So all these things, sometimes it could be a threat for them, for personal security, from the police and the security department. So these are considered, they might be considered as, you know, persons of, you know, suspected persons, let's say, you know. They might be, in the view of the Jordanian authorities, like terrorists or people who are intending to do something to harm the country's security. So this is one of the major problems that the refugees and the migrants are facing these days, which is the expensive rent subsidies that they cannot afford. So Caritas with another NGOs are trying to bridge this gap by securing them with the fees, the rent fees or the rent subsidies they have to pay in order to stay in a decent place and provide them with all what they need in their house as far as households and house maintenance is concerned. So all these issues are, you know, causing burdens on the let's say the stay of the refugees and migrants in Jordan. So this is another burden they are facing.
I think there are several initiatives that are taking place, and I think much more needs to be done to enhance these initiatives. Let's say now in the Middle East and in North Africa today, we have so much of conflict, so much of war, and a lot of these conflicts, lots of these wars, while people term it as civil wars, actually we all know are not civil wars. There are big powers that are involved in it. There are, you know, the military industrial establishment that is involved in it. One has to ask oneself, how is that factions and groups across the board in different parts of the Middle East and in North Africa can have access to so many arms and ammunition? There is also the dynamic of where people on the ground literally have no choice. You know, they become victims to somebody else's war. Maybe there are rebel groups in each of these countries. There are people seeking greater freedom, greater democracy. There are these issues which need to be placed on board. But I think in terms of initiatives, the initiatives very specially that can mitigate the impact are, first is, can we check what I would call the attitudes of people in terms of the others, in terms of the excluded, in terms of the marginalized? And these attitudes have to be in place both where IDPs are concerned. I've seen it happening, you know, in places like Syria, and there also now in places like Erbil there in Iraq. We have people who have been living in a particular area for a long time and who always feel threatened when people from outside, even if it's their own countrymen and women, come to a particular place. How do we check attitudes? There are lots of initiatives that are in place that help in this. Initiatives that bring about attitudinal changes, which address behavioral patterns, that look into possibilities of counseling, of trauma healing, of responding to what people are going through. Now, I think it is important for these practices, these initiatives, to have an important place where migration is concerned, where host communities are concerned. Another initiative is local capacities for peace. How do we get local communities to ensure that peace is possible, that inclusion is possible? This goes beyond what I said in my first point, merely in terms of attitudinal and behavioral changes which are necessary. These are like, say, are tangible practices. How do we create zones in which people from maybe what we call warring factions, from different ethnic groups, are able to sit together like a common marketplace? They need to go to a common marketplace where people from across maybe the groups, the warring factions, need to come together even to buy their weekly purchase. How do we create maybe zones of peace in these areas? And this in a way can address, you know, and make communities, I would think, more resilient. The third is also is schooling. And I think for me, schooling and education is very important. how do we create, when people come from outside, how does the host community create space in the formal schooling of that particular host community? So that, say now, in Lebanon, we have maybe Syrian children sitting in the same classrooms as the Lebanese children, studying together, playing together, exchanging. Because, once we look into certain cultural practices, there is not much difference. So in order to mitigate maybe the conflict, in order to mitigate the divide, what we need to do is to be able to create the possibilities for children to study together, to eat together, to play together, and for the parents of these children ultimately to come together. I think once we enhance such initiatives, many of these initiatives are already in practice in many areas of the Middle East and of North Africa, but we need to enhance it. We need to bring about maybe a qualitative change in the lives of people through these initiatives. In that sense, we can make communities more resilient, more vibrant.
The people of Iraq have different objectives when they plan to exit from the country. Europe is not much the most important objective they have. And there is a reason, because previous exit from the country due to previous difficulties, that is previous conflict or political difficulties here, directed people in Australia, in New Zealand, in United States, and in United States, yes. Now, the IDPs that intends to go out tends to follow this line, and so then Europe is not the most important things. Some of them try to immigrate in Europe, of course, because the pressure was so much, and some of the IDPs try to emigrate in Europe, but many of them returned here with negative comments on the reception they have obtained in different countries. And so this cooled down the trend to Europe. But some of them also tried to reach Germany or Sweden, going through Turkey and then Greece and then all the line up. Some of them came back because they were dead. I mean, they were some of them died on the Aegean Sea because they were trying to cross. Everybody knows about it. They're crossing the water with the rubber boats. No, we even in our camp we had some effect on that. People who went away and then returned only with the coffins, and so this removed a bit the idea of reaching Europe. This is what is happening now. But some of the Kurdish population that are feeling and have opportunities, the Kurdish population tends to go to Europe because they have a previous connection on this line. So it depends on what they had, their story of the families of some years ago. This is what is happening now anyway. Europe is not the best final position for them. The IDPs at least.
Okay, and...
Well, this question is a little bit, it has many interpretations. And, mainly the refugees in Jordan are staying in designed or designated places. Actually, they are... There are two types of people who are coming, migrants and refugees coming to Jordan. People who stay in the refugee camps, those who cross the border illegally, and they were placed in camps, tents, special tents made in a complex or something like an area, big area, with a big number of tents that were changed to caravans. They had to stay in these caravans until, you know, since they're coming to Jordan back in 2011, and so far they are still waiting, or let's say, staying in these caravans. And they are all provided with all kinds of assistance and aid they receive from NGOs, Jordanian government, and the international community. You know, donor countries, of course, like US, Canada, Germany, Switzerland, and as well as some Arab countries like the Gulf, the countries that who are, you know, that they are interested in this crisis and willing to assist Jordan in this burden. This is one kind of people. Of course, as you can see, that they are living here in big numbers, and in a, you know, there's some be some they are staying under difficult weather conditions, especially in winter time. There are, you know, snow and blizzards that hit the area, and sometimes it ended up with having these refugees losing their houses, their tents, or their places of stay. There are fires, or, you know, that might erupt from now and then because of sometimes of lack of knowledge how to use these let's say the heaters in winter, and some other issues that harm them, and of course it harmed the environment in that area. The other types of people, who came to Jordan, say legally to Jordan with their passports before the closure of the border, and they had to rent houses, you know, adjacent to the Jordanians' neighboring areas, and of course, they will have to pay rent, or some of them are staying with friends or family members who came before them to Jordan. So this is another, you know, type of people who have to live in Jordan. Of course, living on assistance from the NGOs and the government of Jordan in the fields of health, education, and livelihood, of course, as newly the Jordanian government has allowed refugees to work here in Jordan, you know, under conditions that those professions that they are supposed to work in are not taken by Jordanians, and the non-skilled, of course, workers who can help in the construction and agriculture and other industrial zones, for example, to help Jordan overcome and help, of course, their families and themselves to overcome the difficulties they are living in.
Well, just now there are enough of statistics to say that Europe takes just 10% of the refugees that are just now, you know, in the world. There are enough of statistics to show it, and I think we have to understand that there is. Some degree of exaggeration, say, where Europe and the refugees are concerned. Europe will have to accept maybe three things. First of all, many parts of Europe have in the past been colonial powers. Okay? They have been, I think this is a historical fact which people are too afraid, you know, or do not want to address. And over the years, Europe has always welcomed migrants. There are people from various parts of Africa who are living in different countries of Europe, various parts of Asia, various parts of Latin America who are living in Europe today. Migration has been an accepted policy, you know, even in Europe. Years ago, you know, in the bigger airports of the world, you know, like say the Frankfurt airport, we saw lots of migrant population doing a lot of the work which maybe Europeans today would not easily be doing. You know, numbers are dwindling in Europe and manpower is necessary. And Europe has always welcomed some degree of migration. This is another point which needs to be placed on board. The third factor is that Europe has always been a multicultural and a pluralistic society. Okay? And I think most parts of Europe. And I think this has to be welcomed. Multiculturalism, pluralism in any society helps in the growth of a society. So when you're talking about the amount of people, coming into Europe, we have to admit in terms of just in the Middle East, Lebanon, one out of every four persons here is a refugee. Jordan has a very high percentage of refugees. Turkey has millions of refugees. We need to accept these facts that most of the refugees, most of IDPs staying on in their own countries, like there in Erbil or perhaps in Syria, there are many millions who are still in other parts of Syria. But if one talks about refugees, one has to be able to accept and realize that Jordan, Lebanon and Turkey are three of the major countries that have accepted most of the refugees mainly from the Palestinian area in the past, from Iraq and from Syria today. So that's a fact. There is enough of statistical data that proves this. Now the point is there is a fear that it's going to become a kind of a natural and environmental disaster. It is true. Even in Europe, resources are limited, whether it is food, agricultural products, whether it is land, whether it is water, whether it is energy. Okay? But I think there should be a paradigm shift. I strongly believe in it. Even in the minds of Europeans, in the minds of those who are there in the host communities, how do we create spaces where we can become a more inclusive society? How are we able maybe to cut down on consumption patterns? There is a lot of energy which is being consumed every day, and energy is very limited. How do we shift, maybe as some countries in Europe are actually doing, to solar energy, which makes it possible to share maybe the energy that we have, with the influx, in inverted commas, of the refugees we have. So I think Europe can do several things. But first of all, Europe would need a political will. The heads of governments, the prime ministers, the presidents, those who govern Europe today need to come together and demonstrate a political will to address a reality that is affecting the whole world. And Pope Francis has constantly been speaking about this. We have to demonstrate a political will to be more welcoming. And there is a whole campaign that has been launched all over the world by civil society, by the United Nations itself, to try to ensure that our society is very particularly in Europe becoming more welcoming. It is true that people feel threatened, very especially if somebody is old, somebody is living in a particular cultural or ethnic zone of comfort. When people from outside come, maybe with a different religious belief, with a different cultural practice, people are bound to feel threatened. And we need to address this. So how do we create greater sensitivities, both on those people coming into Europe and those who are already living in Europe, have a greater sensitivity and the greater possibility of adjustment, of adaptation, and also about respect for the other's rights and privileges? How do we create this? And I'm really not sure about whether the situation calls for such serious alarm that that they become environmental refugees and so on. If checks and balances are in place, if certain controls are there, and Europe is definitely, most of the countries of Europe have plenty of safeguards, environmental safeguards. how do the law and order mechanism, how do the governments ensure that their environmental laws are respected, that the share of land, water, other natural resources, energy, food, whatever, you know, is also shared? How do we cut down on waste? This is important. How do we try to recycle? How do we use alternative sources of energy? Europe definitely has the potential. It has the capacity. It has the capability of entering into these new avenues. And I think at a time like this, when the world needs it, Europe did it, at the time of the Second World War. And Europe should definitely rise to the occasion and tell the world, we have the capacity, we have the capability to rise to the occasion.
Now, the responsibility of the government, the civil society, and the international organizations are absolutely different from each other. Each has got a very clear responsibility. The government should be more transparent about the management of financial conditions that are critical for the services and the well-being that they have to give to the population. So they have to be very keen in offering a good way of showing what they are doing in managing the availability of the country. The civil society should operate to engage people in helping people to define policies that eventually can help the government to direct the expenditure in a good way. The transparency of the government and the civil society together can obtain good results if they work together. The international organizations are engaged mostly on the emergencies, so they are supposed to support the refugees and the IDPs, and eventually they have to give the opportunity for a return of these people to the town which are going to be liberated. The point is that the IDPs that want to go, they want to go to back to their own houses and their own town, they are asking very, very strongly to have security, for example. So the three elements can work together only if they coordinate their effort. Otherwise, everyone is doing his own interest, and that is what is eventually reducing the impact of the all three elements.
Yeah, well, actually, all parties who are concerned about the refugees and the migrants who come to Jordan are trying to make some kind of, mutual effort or close coordination, that they meet regularly and try to coordinate their work together in the country so as to share the responsibility and the burden, of course. Well, some bodies or some international organizations here in Jordan are working on their rights of, for example, to have a good house and to decent living, to enjoy a decent living here in Jordan. Others are concerned about their legal rights and what they should do and what they are obliged to do in order to stay here in Jordan and enjoy a normal life. Others, for example, are taking care of the issues, concerning the birth and the civil statute of the people here in Jordan in terms of newly born babies, for example, marriage contracts and some other issues like legalizing their stay here in Jordan with the authorities and be informed about their rights as refugees and their obligations towards the country and to the to the organizations that are assisting them. So all these efforts are doing a great job together. And Caritas, of course, is one of these organizations that works with others in order to secure all these services and provide these people with decent housing conditions, with households, with, let's say, consultation, psychosocial support, and they give them access to visit these legal organizations that defend their rights and advocate for their stay in Jordan for longer periods of time without having the problem or the threat to be deported to, you know, to their countries or to other countries.
I think this is a very crucial question. Governments, civil society, international organizations need to come together. They have to be on the same page. There are many, many organizations, international NGOs, there are United Nations organizations, there are governments. And unless there is a synergy created among these different arms of society, you know, we will not be able to address this reality. I think they need to be able to do three things. First of all, to come together and sit at the same table. You know, I do not think there is any alternative to dialogue. We need to dialogue. We need to put all our cards on the table. We need to put the resources that we have available, you know, on this and say who can do what. Government needs to play a supervisory role. You know, the United Nations has a tremendous outreach all over, say, the Middle East, in Europe. You know, they have their headquarters in, most of their headquarters in the Western nations, whether it is in New York, whether it is in Geneva. Of course, we also know parts of it are in African, like Nairobi and so on. But the key organizations are either New York or in Geneva. So the United Nations has an outreach. We have a lot of the NGOs who are doing excellent work today in terms of responding to the needs and cries of refugees, of IDPs, who are also based, many of them are based in Europe. So how can these three important arms of society, you know, civil society, the governments, and the United Nations agencies, sit together and begin a dialogue, begin talking? We have had some important things. Just some months ago, we had, you know, the World Summit in Istanbul. A lot of talking, a lot of dialogue did take place there. But while dialogue is important, we need to move into a second stage, the stage of implementation. And very often, we need to have, there will be gray areas, there will be overlapping, there will be times and moments when maybe we have duplication. There will be moments and occasions when those who are not deserving maybe of help or accompaniment or service gets the benefit and somebody is left out. These things are bound to happen. It happens in any society. And this is tragic, this is sad, and we need to see how best we can avoid it. But we come to the second factor, and how best can we implement things? We take decisions, and very often, it's all theory, it's all good ideals, it's all good promises, it's an MOU, it's a document, it's all very interesting. But we need to be pragmatic, because the reality we are faced today, whether it is in Europe, whether it is here in the Middle East and in North Africa, we are faced with an immense crisis. And we need to be pragmatic, come out with pragmatic solutions, so that the people who are really deserving of these, this help, this aid, this response, this advocacy, this service, this accompaniment, really become the beneficiaries. And in the third sense, we need to see how best. Now, we know there are lots of examples from the United Nations, from governments like in Germany and so on. You know, Italy too has taken several people, you know, and these are contributing to the local society. They are contributing very positively, in spite of being refugees, in spite of being migrants, they are contributing to the economy and the growth of that particular society. I think the governments, the United Nations agencies, civil society,
must look into ways and means of providing education, of providing skill training, of providing perhaps livelihood generation, whatever it is, so that the people who come from outside ultimately contribute to the good of that society, contribute to the economic growth. They contribute very heavily to multiculturalism, to multi-pluralism. That is very important. But they can also contribute substantially to the economic growth and to a healthier political climate, you know, of any society which they belong to. What is important is that governments, United Nations agencies, and civil society need to sit together, you know, to in order to support a more humanitarian and the developmental needs of the IDPs that are living today in Syria or Iraq, and also those who come out into other countries, particularly the few who come into Europe.